Hey everybody, welcome to Geekoholics Anonymous episode 132. I'm your sick ass co-host, or co-host, host.
Yeah, you're my co-host.
Yeah, Dane's taking over. I've been fired. My lame sick ass with my co-host.
Mr. Dane Cody.
Mr. Dane Cody. Yeah, see, man, the drugs got me all messed up.
The drugs are the drugs and the drugs like you.
I assume that was a song, but I have no idea what song it is.
Really? Marilyn Manson? Drugs?
Yeah, nope.
Yeah, never mind.
I'm sure someone out there appreciates your singing.
Yeah.
If you've never been here before, welcome. We get together once a week, talk about video games, TV, movies, and or whatever the hell we like. And this eve of Thanksgiving, for our American friends, we're definitely going to be talking about some video games.
Yeah.
Some controversial video games. Oh, boy. We'll get to that. But yeah, before we get to the news, we usually start the show with some what you've been playing. Getting some news, our public service announcements, and free-for-all section. And of course, our new section at the top of the show where we just shoot the shit, the BS section, which I don't know if I really have anything to add besides that I'm sick as a dog.
Yeah, you sound like it.
And didn't go to work today, which was good and bad. Good that I got to play lots of video games. Bad that I feel like I got ran over by a reindeer.
Fair enough.
Unlike all our American friends who have like super long weekend this weekend, like, geez.
Lucky and guys. Me.
You took the time off?
Heck yeah, buddy.
So you're off.
I am.
Thursday and Friday?
I'm on holidays essentially starting right now.
For everyone who doesn't know our evil trick, we record on Wednesday, not Thursday when the show comes out. But I think y'all knew that. So yeah, happy Thanksgiving. Hope you're, like, by the time you listen to this in the evening, you're going to be all stuffed with your yummy turkey and all the beautiful stuff that comes with it. And then you'll be trampling each other for some freaking Black Friday deals.
Oh, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to eat the stuff, but I'm not going to trample anybody.
Are you traveling to the U.S. for the holiday, or are you just staying here with your wifey?
Staying here and cooking turkey.
Does she have family coming here, or do you guys just have
friends?
Hell
no. Are you crazy?
Oh, just you guys. Nice. That's all right. That sounds awesome.
Yeah, no, no. We stay here and just do it, and yeah, it's much better that way.
Was it last year that you went down there and it was a total disaster? It was a different holiday.
Nope, we've stayed up here for American Thanksgiving, I think every year, actually.
I'm trying to remember the trip you made down south when you were stuck in Seattle for like 5 years.
Well, there's been several.
But that was a holiday, wasn't it? Were you guys just visiting? Yeah, it's
we might have just been
there.
Well, we visited earlier in the year. That was when we got stuck in the like horrible traffic down into Portland. That was when we went to visit.
Yeah, that's it. You were super happy about it. That was just a
weekend visit to the family.
Ugh.
Yeah, with the super brutal traffic bullshit that we had to deal with. So,
I'm trying to think if anything eventful happened on this end besides playing vids. I don't think so.
Sweet.
No, it was a pretty chill weekend. No crazy events that I can think of.
Yeah, I'm not going to lie. Our weekend was pretty chill as well, actually.
With that being said, I guess we can get into what you've been playing. So I've been playing Star Wars Battlefront 2.
Nice.
The controversial Star Wars Battlefront 2. If you've never listened to the show or have had your head in a hole in the ground, you probably should be aware of all the drama surrounding loot boxes in this game. I will try and stay away from that.
It's kind of hard.
Until we get into the news, because we do have some stories about loot boxes. Well, it's kind of hard not to talk about it. at the same time, but we'll talk about it after I talk about the game. How's that sound?
All right.
We're gonna poach some stuff from news, but so yeah, I've been playing Star Wars Battlefront 2. I purchased it on I think it was like an E3 / also price error discount on Amazon, so I got it for $50 Canadian,
right?
Which is the only reason I didn't cancel, because of all the hoopla and negative press I heard. I was honestly going, I'm not paying full price for this game. But since I got it for $50, I'm like, yeah, I can afford to check it out. And I had I had a curiosity to see the campaign, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So, Star Wars Battlefront 2.
Yeah.
How do we start?
I don't know. You're the one playing it, man.
It's
walk me through it. Is it?
It's not bad. The internet would have you believe this game is a steaming pile of garbage, but it's just okay to good. If you were just an average gamer or mass market gamer who just picked this game up on a whim or was gifted it, you'll probably be happy with it.
Right.
If you're a super hardcore gamer, you might see some of the flaws and not enjoy it so much. If you're a Star Wars fan, you will probably definitely see past the or ignore the flaws and probably enjoy this game more than anyone else.
Right.
You know, there's a lot of Star Wars nostalgia going on. That soundtrack, every time, you know, nothing beats jumping in an X-Wing or a TIE fighter.
Yeah, hearing all those sounds and the lightsabers and the lasers and everything else.
So, this game takes place essentially immediately after Return of the Jedi.
Right.
And you are Commander Versio, and I want to say Iden, or it's I'm like blanking on her first name.
Okay.
Right now. But anyway, Commander Versio, leader of Inferno Squad, elite group of stormtroopers. You got the cool black armor. You guys kick ass. You're the
badasses. Fucking,
yeah, you're the badasses.
So you're kind of like the special forces dudes.
Yeah.
Okay.
And basically, the first couple of missions, you're seeing the events of Return of Jedi from basically the Empire ground troop angle. So, on Endor, seeing the rebels, you know, Han and Luke taking out the shield generator, and then, spoiler alert, witnessing the Death Star blow up.
Right.
You know, end of Jedi. Everyone's happy, dancing with Ewoks and so forth. And basically, the Empire's scrambling to regroup and continue, you know, their tyranny through the galaxy.
Right, okay.
You know, there's no Empire, but there's still... the Empire has its motives, and it's going around different planets and, you know, basically flexing their muscle on citizens and making the Empire, you know, a force to be feared still. And, you know, with the destruction of the Death Star doesn't mean we're done, right?
Right.
So you're going on missions as Inferno crew, and it's a little spoilery. I'll try not to spoil it too much. But obviously, it's pretty obvious, okay? Don't listen for like 30 seconds or a minute, okay? Here's your spoiler. This is major spoiler, but so plug your ears starting now. Your crew essentially has a change of heart and goes through the whole, we're fighting for the wrong side.
Really? No way.
Yeah, I know.
Never have thought that would happen.
Seemed pretty freaking obvious.
That actually really bums me out. I was really hoping that they weren't gonna do something like that.
I really thought they were gonna toe the line and just stay bad the whole time, but yeah, I guess. Anyway, so okay, that's it for spoilers. So the campaign is a mishmash of first person shooter levels or third person. You can change the camera from first to third.
Right, okay.
Stitched in with you know, your star your space battle levels. Like I said, you're in the TIE fighter or an X-wing and other vehicles. There's other ones as well. And there's also ground vehicles and so forth. And it's not, I don't know, some people make it out to be like terrible, like just bad. It's not amazing. It's not good. Like Destiny 2's campaign is much better, makes more sense, has a better, you know, storyline than I would say this does. But I don't know. I enjoyed the set pieces and the journey. And my favorite parts were the space battles. Like, I loved that because it was basically, you know, the VR mission.
Yeah,
it was like more. That. It was more of those, except for not in VR.
Okay,
which is pretty cool, and they have a whole multiplayer mode based around that, which I did play some of.
Sweet.
And you play as Versio, and you go through and play also other hero characters as they take you through the story, because it takes place after Jedi, and then It leads into the new Star Wars.
Right.
So it does a big jump like 30 years later.
Or oh, wow.
Decades, decades later. Which
really that, go there. Okay.
That's where I would say the story's pretty weak. And
I've heard it's very fan servicey. Like it kind of feels. Somebody explained it to me as it's Star Wars fan fiction and they decided to make a game with it.
Yeah, it's definitely. Seems a little fanficky. It is fun, though, playing as some of the heroes. I will say I did have a few bugs in the game where I would come back from sleep mode. And I'm playing on an Xbox One X.
Yep.
Where the game would be, like, on fast forward.
Oh, weird.
Yeah, it's like the frame limiter or something was turned off. And the game would just... I would be, like, running around the screen, like, super fast. I took some videos of it, but I have no idea how to share the videos on Xbox.
Okay.
Online, I got to dig into it, but it's so weird. Anyway.
It sounds very weird.
Yeah, it is weird. And then I had to quit the game and reboot it to fix it. It's not the longest campaign. I think I beat it in 3, maybe 4 sittings.
Yeah, I'm hearing between 4 and 6 hours if you
really I want to say I was between the 5 and 6 hour because I'm not super fast. If you run through it, I imagine you can get through it in 4 hours or even less.
Wow.
Because in some sections, you don't necessarily have to clear all the enemies out. You just have to get from here to there. But I like killing stormtroopers. Like, that's the one thing this game gets very right is the visual style of Star Wars, from the sound effects to the graphical effects and the aesthetic. Like, you're in Star Wars. When you shoot your blasters and your blaster hits the wall, that puff of smoke, like you remember so vividly from A New Hope when blasters are like hitting walls and shooting stuff.
Yeah.
It's like, it's identical. Like, it plays such close homage to like every aspect of Star Wars, from like the little details of how, you know, the hallways look in the, you know, the Empire's ships to, that, you know, that shine on the walls and so forth. Every aspect of the game is just so lovingly crafted visually. It's a beautiful game.
Yeah.
Some levels.
Very aesthetically pleasing.
Not so much. Like, it's so wild. Like, one level will look amazing, then one will look just like, eh.
Oh, really?
Like, it's just, it's up and down. It's not, I don't know. It's not like, like even Titanfall's campaign or Infinite Warfare, where it was just like a roller coaster ride that you're just super excited to keep going on. It was like a peak, be really good, and then the pace would change so much because you'd be a different character doing something else. And some of the missions like really didn't add or contribute to the story as a whole. Like, some missions, like, they just threw this in here for like just so they can check that box off that you did this thing. It was like totally unnecessary. Those are pretty. Yeah. I feel like those are pretty much most of, if not all, the hero missions in the campaign are like that. They're just kind of just shoved in so they can, you know.
You get to play as Darth Vader. You get to play as Luke Skywalker, and you get to tick those boxes and try
exactly. And to be honest, like,
help.
It's a little
people.
Disappointing besides the story portions of the level that you play as Luke, the story portions of it are really good.
Yeah.
But the actual gameplay of it is really bad. Like, it's like, when I was playing that level, I'm like, what is going on here? This is like PS1, PS2.
Really?
They have you fighting these bugs, and it just, the animation on them is terrible, and the movement is so wonky. It just feels like just so out of place. It doesn't feel good or look good. It's just like, what game am I playing? So there's moments like that where it's like super janky. And then, you know, the next level you're flying a fucking X-Wing and you're destroying star, you know.
Right.
Freaking Empire. What do they call the big fucking Star Destroyers?
Right.
And that's always awesome.
I mean, what you're telling me is a lot of what I've heard, that it's, the story is kind of weak. It's fun.
Yeah, but it's fine, man.
Like, it's not a great story, but it's also not worth spending the $60 just to play the single player.
No, like I said,
very short.
Full price, I probably would have been disappointed. If this game goes on sale, though, it's not bad. And if you're like a Star Wars person, you'll like it a lot more. Like, I'm higher on the good scale. It's not awesome, but some people who may not care for Star Wars too much probably, you know, are going to be closer to the bad on it. It is kind of short. It is all over the place, but yeah. Full price, I'd probably be disappointed more, but on a sale. Now, I don't know much about the multiplayer because I never played the first multiplayer or really care for the multiplayer. I did play some multiplayer. I played Starfighter Assault. I'm not even sure what they call it, but it's just the strict flying dogfighting mode.
Okay, interesting. So there's actually like a flying only multiplayer mode.
Yeah.
Oh, that's kind of cool.
So it obviously Empire versus Rebels. Choose a ship type. So there's multiple ship types.
Right.
A TIE fighter. Interceptor, a TIE bomber. And the way the multiplayer works in these games, if you weren't familiar with the old one, I don't know how it works for the ground missions because I never played a ground one.
Okay.
Like, I haven't played non-foot one. I've only been playing the Starfighter ones because I'm just like, eh. I had enough time. I beat the campaign so I could talk about that. I'll come back and report on multiplayer next week. Some
the
more.
The multiplayer feels like a Battlefield game, but with Star Wars.
Yeah, well, I'm sure there's more nuance to that, so I'm going to check it out, but I just didn't have time today. I just was playing what I really liked, what I wanted more of, which was the flying sections. And basically, you choose a different fighter, and they're objective-based maps. Defend this, defend the shield generators, or destroy the, you know, the frigates, or this or that, right? So it's like a push and pull, attack, defend, back and forth.
Okay, yeah.
And obviously it progresses one way or another depending on what team is doing really well. And as you play, you get battle points.
Right.
And that's when you can spawn in with like some of the hero ships, like Kylo Ren's ship, his TIE interceptor,
right,
or Boba Fett's Slave One. And
okay.
I don't know.
So that's so like as you play, so instead it's kind of like in Call of Duty, you get,
it's like a kill streak,
it's like
a score
streak
that everyone can get because it's not determined by you actually getting 5 kills in a row. It's just you're doing decent and getting score.
Right.
Or points, battle points, right? It's kind of like economy, like Counter-Strike or something, right? As you
get
kills.
Yeah, that makes sense. You can spawn as one of those characters.
Yeah,
or so in your case, one of the TIE fighters or whatever.
So that's why I'm interested to see what the ground missions are like, if it's the same way. Because in the first game, when it came to controlling vehicles and stuff, they were just a stupid icon on the ground, and whoever ran there first magically was teleported into an AT-AT or a TIE fighter or whatever, right?
Yeah.
So I really wonder how that works in those missions, which I will play. But I just didn't have time. I like that mode. That mode's cool. I wish there was like just a offline mode of it. There might be, and I just haven't been able to find it because I would just play that over and over again.
That's funny.
I really like the space combat games. Like, I miss like Colony Wars and stuff from back in the day. So it reminds me of that. And I'm pretty sure Criterion does these like they did the VR section last year.
Mm-hmm.
They're pretty cool. They're awesome when you're whipping around these environments. So, you know, flying the freaking Millennium Falcon and shit. Stuff like that is like, oh, this is cool. And then there's everything that's wrong with this game.
Right.
You know, like the whole freaking loot box thing. So we talked about it last week and the week before and probably the freaking week before. How much shit they've been getting in, because basically most people just have figured that the unlocks and progression system in this game are essentially broken, or they're just terrible. It's a huge grind with little reward, and the incentive is to spend money on loot boxes. So it's just been negative press, negative story, negative, negative, negative. The only story about this game is how EA is screwing everyone with loot boxes. That's been the main message on this. So at the last minute, like hours before launch on Thursday night last week, word is exec from Disney was like, called EA and they're like, pull the plug on that shit. So last minute, they're like, oh yeah, we're disabling all in-game transactions. So you can't spend real money on loot crates. You can still buy loot crates with the currency you earn in-game.
Currency, but you can't spend real money to buy crystals to buy loot crates.
So people who, I guess, who had spent currency or money or real money earlier before this happened, because it was in, EA Access title.
Yeah.
You know, I'm assuming they got their boosts and kept their boosts. we were talking about last week, how they reduced the costs of everything, I think was the story last week. That was one of their attempts at fixing the economy.
Well, they dropped the cost or the in-game cost of all of that stuff like, by 75%
before like, the I game understand, even came out. Like, seeing there's not that many characters to unlock, so I understand why maybe the grind was pretty big, but the progression system is just so weird in this game, like with the star cards and the different level of cards and crafting them. It's such a super convoluted system. It's not so clear cut like a Call of Duty multiplayer where it's like, I hit level 6 and I unlock the new gun. Oh, I got 50 headshots and now I got the new sight, or you know what I mean?
Yep.
It's like, it's all up to, for the most part, hopefully getting a card that boosts an ability that you like or use.
Right.
You know, you're going to get cards of shit you don't even use. So,
well, and as I understand it, you like essentially everything is tied to those loot boxes.
Yeah. Everything.
So like you make in-game currency, then you spend it to get a loot box.
Yeah.
In hopes of getting something useful.
Which gives you credits and gives you crafting materials.
So it's like there's no way around, even though they've shut off, like even right now, they've shut off being able to spend money on it. But at the same time, the whole progression system is loot crates.
Yeah.
So everybody now just has to deal with it.
That's the problem. Like the progression's fucked.
And I've heard that it's just not a good system.
No, it's not.
From everybody not that I'm essentially talking to that's playing the game.
I barely even understand it. It's like so confusing. And I don't know what, man, they really. And it's so weird when you open loot boxes up. It's like, oh, cool. This loot box had 5 cards in it. Okay, these ones only have 2. I'm like, what? Why is it like 50? Why is there 50 different types of loot boxes? So it's like they even have different values. So they were designed to juke you out of more money. Like, why isn't there just one loot box with 5 things and it's all the same and you buy it with real money or you know, it's not only did they screw the system up with how all your progression is locked to these crates. The different crates, they're like an even other unnecessary layer to the whole fucking mess. Ugh.
Yeah.
I'm hoping what happens is they keep them off. I don't know how they can revamp this progression system quickly. I imagine it's going to be at least a month, maybe two, and then this game will have a different progression system.
I just want to know who on earth...
I'm pretty sure whoever was involved with it and okayed this...
is getting fired, I hope.
I don't know how you can generate this much negative press. Potentially... get Disney's ire, which may lose EA the Star Wars license.
See, okay, so I've heard people talking about that. Here's the thing that I have a hard time believing is that Disney wasn't involved in the whole game being developed in the first place. I guarantee you that with this much of a Star Wars license involved, I guarantee you that they knew exactly what was going on. They approved
everything along the
way. Exactly.
But they didn't. And now they're just going like, the system.
No, but I'm sure they approved it all. They knew exactly what was happening. Yeah, it's the only reason they're saying anything now is because, oh man, we might not make as much money as we were gonna.
You got to give them the benefit of the doubt, though, that they're not game designers. So they, to them, you know, when DICE or EA or whoever came up with this progression loot system came to them, they were essentially speaking Chinese to Disney execs, and they're like, oh, more money? Perfect. Okay, that sounds awesome.
Yeah, really, I just like I don't want people to think that Disney is the shining knight here.
No,
fucking not. But it's fucking Disney. They're trying to buy the world right now, for God's sake.
Like, in the end, though, they're like, no amount of negative press is worth whatever shit little money they're going to make off of this. Because let's be honest, Disney makes billions of dollars. They probably wouldn't even notice what they're not going to make from this. The name brand damage is not worth the price.
Oh, sure. And that, I believe, them going like, shit, we're getting blasted in the press. I think what it had more to do with was, like, this is starting to draw the eye of legislators in the EU. Yeah. And, so like, this has gotten to a breaking point where it has the potential to really kick a hornet's nest of a shitstorm.
So this is our news, like the news stories, because they're related directly to this game. So we're going to cherry pick some of this here. So like we talked about them removing the microtransactions, but obviously all this press has gotten, you know, financial websites talking about the game.
Yeah, like there was talk on CNN for crying out loud during their business.
Facebook parenting groups are posting like stories and warnings about don't buy this game. It's designed to rob money from your kids. So because of all of this now, at the time when I wrote down the outline, Belgium was the first major government to be like, you know what? This shit's fucking gambling and we're going to move to ban this shit in Europe. Like,
yep.
This is straight up gambling. And then Hawaii's jumped on and they're calling it predatory behavior. There'll be notes in the podcast notes if you want to read more about these countries' actions they're taking. But man, they fucked up. Now they got the microscope on this whole system, and I bet you a lot of people are not very happy with EA right now. They're like, dude, you're fucking shit up here for us.
Oh, yeah.
And last thing we want is government regulating stuff, you know, let alone, like, we don't know what could possibly happen because of this. One, if loot boxes are completely gone, hey, our games go up 20, 30 bucks. Oh, rad, sweet.
Right.
Just because they fucked it up and abused the system. Whereas other people have had a decent balance of how to do it, i.e. Overwatch, however you feel about loot boxes, I feel like Overwatch is the only one that does it okay.
Yeah, which I find kind of amusing because I feel like in a weird way, Overwatch is, because of the success of Overwatch, it is what's causing, a lot of these other guys to go, holy shit, we could make $1 billion off of loot boxes? Honey, start the car. We're making loot boxes.
Yeah, like, exactly.
You know, and part of that is because of fucking Overwatch. You know, like they're the ones that they weren't the first one.
No, they weren't the first, but I'd
like
say
blind boxes. But I would just
I think that they're the one that made everybody else sit up and take notice.
No, for sure. Because
they went, holy shit, we could sell our game for $40 and then sell loot boxes.
When Activision is in their earnings call saying, we made $3 billion from in-game purchases.
Exactly.
That really gets everyone's fucking attention. So I don't know what else the government could possibly do. They can really screw things up. That's why you never want the government involved. But because these guys fucked it up so bad, they got this attention.
Especially, let's be perfectly clear here, and I don't mean this in the worst way that it's going to come out, but you especially don't want the American government involved. That shit really get fucked up.
You know, now, okay, one, they outlaw them. Or two, the government's like, oh, this is another tax/revenue stream, so now they're going to tax all in-game purchases. Imagine how much of a pain in the ass that is for devs now.
Oh,
or some other nefarious government freaking harebrained idea they might come up with. The possibilities are endless, and it's good in that it's like, hey, you guys don't do this, but it's bad in that it's like, it's the government and we don't need the government parenting for us. But the goddamn games industry should have been policing themselves on this, and it's really, man, I think EA really missed out on being the worst company for the last couple of years.
Oh, they were doing great. They were kind of on the up and up. And this year, they've had a really weird year.
I think they really missed having that award of being worst video game company, and they wanted it, and they really wanted it bad. what a monumental fuck up on every angle.
Yeah.
This is going to be a developing story. Clearly not the last we're going to hear of it.
And then on top of that, I have a sneaky suspicion that because this got so much bad press, it's going to affect sales significantly.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure.
And that mixed with, from what I understand, the sales of their new Need for Speed game, which is not doing great. That was their two big games that they were hoping to make a bunch of money off of this winter, the holiday season.
To be honest, I don't know.
What else do they have outside of those things?
Well, they've got FIFA, which is the biggest selling game in the world. But yeah,
I'm talking FIFA. Besides FIFA and Madden.
No, they got nothing. Their main tent poles besides the sports games have all pretty much been not selling to expectation lately. Need for Speed's just, I think everyone's just tired of Need for Speed, even though it has gone to the drawing board again.
They haven't made a good Need for Speed game in years, unfortunately. In a long time.
Yeah,
that's the problem. I don't know what they're doing with Need for Speed anymore.
They've driven most of their franchises into the ground by destroying goodwill with their fans. I don't know.
Yeah, or firing their freaking devs or sucking their devs up.
I don't know what the hell they're doing.
I mean, we had at the beginning of the year, you had Mass Effect, which completely.
Yeah, Jesus Christ, they shit. That's what I'm saying.
Like this year has been a very bad year for EA. Like they
no, it's been
outside
terrible.
Of their sports games, which I'm sure are probably still selling, and obviously a back catalog. But man,
well, now that they got all this attention on Star Wars with all this shit about loot boxes, guess where that freaking eye goes next? It goes to FIFA and Ultimate Team and Madden and Ultimate Team and NHL and Ultimate Team and the card packs they're selling there. Which sure as hell are pretty close to gambling.
I've heard some pretty bad things about that.
Let alone the craziness that happens in that whole economy. That's the funny thing. That economy isn't talked about much because it's mainstream gamers. It's not hardcore gamers that go to forums and Reddit and websites and bitch about this stuff.
But the economy is... I mentioned something like this to a friend of mine who's a teacher. And he was telling me that it's a huge thing with kids in the right age group.
Well, there's,
and it's crazy. Like he's overheard kids saying that they've essentially stolen their parents' credit cards.
Oh, yes.
To buy
people
in-game FIFA shit and whatnot. And it's unreal.
That's a huge thing. People, getting basically accounts stolen. For for credit and for the whole sole purpose of buying like card packs and stuff. Yeah, it's a very nasty economy, but we don't really hear about it because none of the geeky nerdy websites, no one's into that shit, so they don't talk about it. But the main, like, the people I hear talk about FIFA and stuff are like, they're all my soccer buddies.
Yeah.
You know, some of them don't play the games that I play, or they, let alone go to video game websites or listen to video game podcasts. But they sure as hell dump a shitload of money into whether it be Madden or FIFA or NHL, buying these card packs and getting totally taken. I don't know. EA has just had a shitty year, and they topped it off with like this just monumental fuck up for the industry. Whoever was involved with any of the decisions, I'm pretty sure does not have a job anymore. And if they did, it would be miraculous.
Yeah, I,
because this is going to have long-standing repercussions.
It might. I mean, especially on what happens, it could,
especially go real bad for EA. Because like, what did we just talk about? The three major, their three major tentpole sports games. Their whole thing is based around loot. You know, their card packs, but they're just fucking loot boxes.
Yeah.
So
a loot box by another name.
Good job, EA. You're gonna get your ass reamed over the coals, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, it's not looking great for them. That's
it's pretty funny with all this nonsense. All the other devs out there on Twitter just kicking them while they're down. Like Witcher 3 devs coming out and being like, we'll leave greed to other devs. Our games are complete packages with everything that you could ever want or need that is part of the game. And then, like,
yeah, I mean, they're a long ways off from their next game showing up. So, my thought on that is like, let's just wait and see. I mean, they've had a good track record, so I'm not concerned that they are not, but it's just one of those things where they're still probably 2 or 3 years away from their game coming out. So till you get your game out there and realize like, oh shit, we haven't released a game in 3 or 4 years and we're broke and we need cash, then, you know, then we'll talk. And also, yeah. Who knows what their publisher is going to come out and say, like, hey fuckers, do this, you know.
Yeah, I think
they're in a bit of a different situation because they're a little bit like Valve, where they've got GOG that's owned by them. So yeah, they kind of have that secondary source.
It's also
of
a single player RPG. It's kind of hard.
Yeah.
Though there is loot boxes in Assassin's Creed. Speaking of which, we can ditch this loot box talk because I've had enough of it. But yeah, so I played Battlefront. Star Wars fan, get it on sale. Super hardcore Star Wars fan, I'm sure you could find something to like in it. If you don't care for Star Wars, I would just stay away.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So
here's the thing I'll say about this on close of this topic. I've said it on the show, and I'll say it again. This is why you don't fucking pre-order games.
Yeah. Unless there's price errors and you get the game for like half price.
Sure. And even then, you might have overpaid.
Yeah, I don't know. I've had fun. I'm going to play more of the Starfighter stuff. I'm going to get my money's worth.
No, fair enough.
I will not give him an extra dime, though.
Yeah.
I really had to peel myself away from Assassin's Creed, which is what I'd rather be playing.
Shit, that game is so good.
I'm level 25 now.
Okay, you might be ahead of me now. I think I'm level 23 or 24.
I just did the mission that we played at PAX.
Oh, really? I'm not quite there yet.
I'm in Memphis.
Oh, I think you and I went opposite directions.
Yeah, I think you can make a different choice.
I went to Giza, to the pyramids there.
Oh, I already
and
did
started
Giza.
Hunting. Okay, so I started hunting the hyena, is yeah, where I'm at.
I did that already.
So I finished the scarab. I'm hunting the hyena now, and that's where I had to end it.
It's funny playing the section that I'm at right now, because we played a demo at PAX, which was like a section of the game ripped out.
Right.
And it's essentially the same like story mission that was included in that gameplay area.
Okay,
but it
yeah,
is quite different because I think a lot of the main plot points were like not in it. I can't remember for certain.
Also, that whole area was completely like essentially 100%ed in our demo, right? So like that
except
whole
for the,
area
except for
like
the one mission.
Yeah, like we essentially had like one mission, and there was like three things that we could do. Yeah. The rest of it was all already unlocked and open, so you could run all over the city and look at everything. But that was kind of
There was no merchants or anything, was there?
Like no, and like, that's what I'm saying. Like they'd kind of cut out a bunch of that stuff as well.
Yeah, it's quite different. So, even the setup to the first part when you come to that area is like totally missing. But there's a really cool. There's a neat storyline mission that opens up that section of the game. When you get there, you'll know instantly what I'm talking about. The really cool thing I'm liking about this game, I like Bayek even more as I keep playing.
Oh, he's great.
He's just a super honorable guy who will help anyone who needs help. And he's a badass.
Yep.
So he's like, I don't know, he's super likable. And it's really cool because he's also like a very spiritual and like religious man. And there's a lot of mysticism and like, you know, nods to magic and the gods, right? They really play up. And mm-hmm. there's some very, very trippy dream sequences in the game, per se. Like, you know, when you kill like one of your assassination marks, those whole sequences that you go through, like, you know what I'm talking about?
Oh, yeah. Yep. I know exactly what you're talking about.
Those are so cool. Like as if you're in the afterlife with your victim having a conversation.
Yeah. It's almost like you go to a plane before they, and you have a conversation with them before they leave this plane to go to the other world.
And they're trying to justify what they did and why they did it.
Yeah.
And those are so,
they're neat moments for sure.
Yeah, there's a lot of sections of the game like that and just other little things. Anyway, there's a mission that you're going to get to eventually that is really cool on that level. It's neat how they explore that kind of stuff, the mysticism of Egypt, which I really like. Right now I find myself, I've been hunting animals because I just want to upgrade all my gear.
Yeah.
Because essentially, you could just start the game and go around hunting animals, and you can essentially craft, like, the best armor set if you just kept plugging away at it.
Yeah, but that stuff isn't necessarily, like, that stuff helps you a lot.
Yeah, it looks cool, though. It upgrades as you upgrade it.
Yeah, no, it does.
I like it visually, it changes.
But you still need actually to upgrade your armor and stuff like that. Because otherwise, you ain't killing shit.
What do you mean your weapons and stuff? Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, because when you upgrade your bracers, you do more damage. So that boosts your weapon combination. When you upgrade your breastplate,
that upgrades your health. Upgrades your defense and your health. Yeah, it gives you more HP.
And then you can upgrade your assassin's blade, so it does more damage. Your quiver and your tool bag, which I've maxed out my tool bag.
I think I'm one away from maxing out my tool bag.
Eventually, they go like rare to legendary, and then to like epic or whatever you want to call the highest tier. Maybe it's legendary.
I thought legendary was the highest tier.
Yeah, well then rare and whatever. But yeah. I've been just doing hunts lately because I think I'm over leveled for the section I'm in because I think it's level 22 and I'm 25.
I've been pretty much over leveled for most of the game because I've been doing all the side quests. Stuff.
Yeah.
Generally speaking, like whenever I roll in, like I'm doing, you know, I'm like level 23 or 24 and I'm doing 18 and 20 stuff still.
Yeah. There's a lot of side quests whenever you roll into a new region. Yeah. I was doing quite a few of those. That's essentially how I've gotten pretty badass. I haven't taken on one of the Phylite guys, those hardcore assassin guys yet.
I did, but I was only a couple levels ahead of him. When I was level 22, I took on the level 20 guy from...
You're saying.
Because each area has one, right? So as you go towards the areas, and they consistently get higher and higher. So they're always consistently usually higher than you are, at least when you're supposed to kind of be in that area.
Yeah.
So like the first guy is level 20. The next guy that you kind of come across is level 22.
Yeah, and those areas
come across a guy that was like level 26.
And I almost bumped into a guy. I swung into an area that I shouldn't have been in because it was way higher level than I was. But he was like level 38.
Oh, Jesus. So and he had a skull over his head and you just
oh,
ran.
Yeah. I just was like, got the hell out of there.
Yeah, I've run into a couple areas that are high level and it's like, oh, I just got one-shotted by an arrow.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Like, let's not go that way again.
Yeah.
Man, it's up there. It's one of my favorite games this year. That game
sucked me in a weird way that I didn't expect at all.
Neither did I. I expected it to be decent and be like, yay, another Assassin's Creed game. But it's like, it's all I want to play.
Yeah, as sad as this is, at least for me personally, I would almost go as far as to say that it might have sucked me in more than Breath of the Wild did.
Yeah, I could see that because it has more.
I'm not saying it's a better game than Breath of the Wild.
They're very.
I'm just saying
games.
That I think it might have sucked me in more.
Yeah, with its storyline, it's not hard to get sucked in.
And it just and the way I love certain changes that they've made. I feel like they're really well done. Like the whole like we talked about it last week where. Just because you get spotted in an area doesn't mean that you're going to have 500 million guys rushing you.
No.
It just means that the people that were within earshot and the people that saw you are going to come over. And unless,
they can set off an alarm, which
yeah,
will
unless
cause
a fire gets
everyone
lit.
On high alert, and that will send more, but not the entire camp won't just come over.
Yeah, exactly. So it doesn't feel like when you get spotted, like, oh shit, I'm fucked. I should probably just restart this whole area again. It's pretty like, okay, I could probably kill a couple of these dudes and then everything will probably go back to normal again, which I really appreciate because I won't lie. That is one of the things from the other Assassin's Creed games that I don't particularly enjoy. Was when I would get spotted and then I would run away and I would try and hide and I would wait for like my, I don't know what you want to call it, your stupid wanted level to go down before you could kind of come out and start trying it again. Because if you didn't wait for that to go back down, then even if you got close to a guy, it was like his radar would just be like, oh, you're here. Ah, and he'd try to attack you and fuck you all up. No, I really like the balance that they've done in this game and mixed with sort of the RPG elements. It's really been my jam. Like I never thought I'd really say that about an Assassin's Creed game. Like this game was kind of on my radar, but I didn't anticipate probably picking it up. Like it was honestly one of those games that I thought, well, maybe I'll pick it up if it's on sale, or maybe I'll throw it on my Christmas list to get given to me. You know, and when we were lucky, so I, you know, it was given to me by Ubisoft, and I'm really glad they did, because like if they wouldn't have, and to be fair, like hearing everybody talk about how good it's been, I probably would have picked it up regardless.
Yeah.
But now having played it, holy shit, I feel like it is one of the top five games. Like if you're playing games this year, you should be playing. Like it is a game that you shouldn't miss if you own a console that it plays on.
It's definitely my top five. Obviously I got a copy as well from Ubisoft, but I wanted to play it on Xbox One, so I liked it so much I went and bought it. So
yeah,
like I went and bought, like I bought a copy even though I was given a copy. Like that's how much I liked this game.
Oh, for sure. No, it's honestly been a real surprise. I did not anticipate enjoying it as much as I have.
Yeah, I can't.
The story's been super solid. Bayek, like he's a character I can get behind. Like he's, like you said, he's a nice guy, but it doesn't feel overly ridiculous. Like it feels like it fits the story.
No, he goes from badass assassin to playing and joking around with his kids and his kids' friends. Like. There's lots of flashbacks in this game, and like he's a father. He's like a family man first, even before he is a Medjay, right? So,
yeah, like, and I feel like he's getting sucked into something that he doesn't necessarily like. He's getting sucked into it, and he's doing what he's doing, but it's not necessarily that he wants to. Like, he's doing it for his reasons,
and in along the way, that's kind of becoming, he's kind of helping other people with their thing, but he's really in it for the reason that he was in it to start with, which is interesting. It's not just like, it's not like he's necessarily getting sucked up in the whole hubbubaloo of like, oh, I need to like help save the world and do this and do that. He feels very down to earth and like, well, that's great. I'm happy you guys are doing that. And I'm gonna help you out because it helps me on my journey. But ultimately, I kind of want this to be over with so that I can get back to my life. He doesn't feel like that person that's just wanting to continue on with this. He
wants his wife back and to live. Yeah, back to living a normal life.
Totally.
Because like, he's just fed up with the whole system, essentially.
Yeah. It's been good.
There's a part where I just, part of the story mission that I just did that I was saying how cool it is. And mm-hmm. I wonder if it's going to hit with you because you're not a parent. But there's a scene, and as a parent, like, I was just playing it this afternoon. Like, I literally, like, teared up. Like, yeah. That doesn't happen often in games. Like, I remember I had the story last year of Infinity War, Infinite Warfare at the end of the credits when the military members were listening to their recordings back to their family home. Like, they were all deceased, right?
Yeah.
And it was, like, their last message to their, like, loved ones and family. And I'm like, wow, this is rough because this is, like, a real life thing. This is something that happens for people out there.
It was heartbreaking.
And it was just, you know, heartbreaking. Even though it was just a video game, I'm like, okay, well, for military families, this is real, right? So anyway, being a parent, like, the main motivator of Assassin's Creed is revenge, right? Like, and this one scene today, I was like, holy crap. I'm like, oh, I totally felt it. Like, it just pulled at my heartstrings. Like, but I don't know if I would have felt that if I wasn't a parent, though.
I'll let you know how it goes.
Yeah. And it was beautifully done. Like, just, we'll talk about it later. But, yeah, I'm loving the game.
You still there? It was like a moment of just thinking about, like, yeah, that game is real good. I kind of just want to go play it. I've put pretty much everything else on hold. Like, it's taken up pretty much all my time.
I would have put a huge chunk into it today, but I wanted to beat Battlefront to talk about it on the show. But I have a feeling I'm not going to go to work tomorrow again, so I'll probably just play Assassin's Creed all day tomorrow. They have the Iron Banner in Destiny 2 going on right now, but I did it on PS4, and it's just armor sets. Like, there's no real benefit besides saying you played a lot of Crucible.
I played some Crucible for the first time on the weekend.
We played some on the weekend. Or on Monday.
I'm not going to lie. I don't feel like it's very good.
It's because you're not good at it. It's awesome when you kill everybody.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know. I'm not...
It's like Halo. It's long time to kill. It's weapon matchups. And definitely, if you're good at jumping around and getting airborne and stuff, you can have a huge advantage on everyone else that's stuck to the floor.
Yeah. Yeah, I can see that.
It's a different... Because people forget that you can, like, fly through the air and jump up on pillars and be out of sight, and there's a lot of mobility, and everyone forgets about it and just stands there shooting each other like old school U.S. Civil War factions standing there blasting each other.
Anyway. Yeah, that wasn't ultimately the problem. I personally wasn't finding it that it was like, it wasn't a mode that I played the couple rounds.
It depends what mode you're playing too. Competitive, I hate competitive.
I wasn't playing competitive.
Competitive, I don't like. It's like there's a mode where you set up a bomb or you defend. I don't like that mode at all.
I was just playing team deathmatch.
Yeah, team deathmatch cycles through like basically like kill confirmed, where you got to pick up the
Yeah, that wasn't the that crystals. One. It was literally just
there's domination, which like A, B, and C. And then, yes, there's just straight up team deathmatch. And I think there might be another mode. But yeah, it depends. You really got to figure out what weapon type you like. Auto rifles are pretty high up in the meta because they're just easy to use.
Yeah.
Same with the scout rifles, but you have to be accurate with a scout rifle. If you're missing shots, you're just going to lose against the other guy if he's better with a scout rifle.
I feel like the hand cannons seem to be real popular.
Hand cannons can be pretty dope, but they're huge. If you're missing your shots, you're forget it. You got to be nailing every shot with them, but they are super deadly.
I'm playing on PC, so that wasn't really a problem for people.
Yeah, we were playing on Monday night, I think, me and Trev. I think we won most of our games. If we weren't at the top of the ladder, the two of us, the first couple of games I was terrible, and then I got in my swing of things, and it's like, okay, I'm coming in first every time. Like, I had an 8 kill streak. I literally humped the other team. I don't know what they were doing. I killed all their members. I came into a room and killed them all. I'm just like, okay, that happened.
Yeah, and see, like, I was never the bottom. Like, I did pretty good multiple times. I don't know. Like, I felt like I was kind of going through the motions. I wasn't all that interested.
Yeah, it clicks or it doesn't. It's not for everyone.
Like, I was just kind of, I guess I have to kind of do this to, like, get my stuff and get the dude off my back.
get your milestone.
Yeah. But ultimately, I was kind of like, I think when I'm done this, I'm kind of done with, I don't know.
There's a lot of people who don't play any of the PvP. And that's the beauty of Destiny. There is a lot of cooperative, modes.
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
And definitely. That's the true, those are the best modes in Destiny. Like, from the strikes to the nightfalls and raid and just fucking around on a planet doing patrols. It's just fun.
Yeah. Yeah, no.
But I like the PvP, but yeah, it can be, sometimes it can be rough because there's some guys out there, teams that are really freaking good.
Yeah. Yeah, I can see that.
Like, you should never win a battle of 2v1. Unless those guys really suck.
Yeah.
But, like, a lot of teams just, I don't know, when you're not communicating to other guys, you're not moving all together. Like, when there's a team who plays together and they're moving as a group, oh, man, that makes things real rough. Because you're getting team shot by 4 people, right? So you go down super quickly if they've got their shit together.
Yeah, I could see that.
It's people, there's definite multiplayer strats for the PvP. Considering there's the super competitive, Trial of the Nine mode,
Have you played any of that?
I did on PS4, and yeah, that was not good. I would like to do it on PC, but we need like 2 other people because you have to match make. You can't match make. You have to have.
Oh, you groups. Have to have a crew.
Yeah, and that's a super hardcore mode.
I didn't realize that the Nightfall Strike, you had to have a crew to get into that. I totally did not realize that, and I was just like, "Oh, cool! I'll
Now you can."
And I jumped in alone. Games. I jumped in alone. I was like, "Oh, it'll just match me up." So I hit the button and then like grabbed something to drink, and I came back and I was standing there all by myself. I'm like, "Oh,
I don't know how the guided games would work for Nightfall because you do need to do some coordination because the modifiers. Apparently, this week is a not very hard one, so."
Yeah, like I said, I'm not sure. Okay, it was funny because I wasn't aware of that. So,
yeah,
like it doesn't say like you have to be in a group.
I think you can you can go to the raid by yourself.
Really?
Yeah, it'll let you load into it. Like I've done that just to explore the environment and like poke my head around.
That's hilarious.
But then you get to a point where it's like, oh, there's 20 enemies. I can't do this.
Well, yeah, that's kind of what happened. It's like I ran across like the first main group of enemies, and there was like a wizard and shit, and they all like kicked my ass. I was like, all right, cool.
They're like, who's this punk ass?
Yeah.
With that, my friend, I'm going to say we can get into some news and stuff. Middle Earth Shadow of War has released a bunch of stuff. Okay, here we go. Never mind. I thought, I'm like, that's the Star Wars story. That's not Middle Earth. They have a bunch of, I think it's free content. No, wait, long three DLCs. Upcoming freebies. That's it. Yeah. So there's, these are freebies. They came out on Monday. No, yesterday on the 21st. Like endless siege mode. What else is there? They've enhanced the photo mode. What else is there? Rebellion. I don't even know what that is. There's a new difficulty. Online fight pits are coming December 5th, where you pitch your orcs versus other people's orcs to earn powerful rewards and stuff.
Right.
Loot, I assume. Yeah, so they're, you know, adding content to that game still. Free content, which is cool. I like that game. Sweet. I like the game a lot. I'll get back to it after Assassin's Creed, maybe.
There's been a lot of big open world games this year. You know,
I did talk about it when the Xbox One X episode, that version of Shadow of War, it's a noticeable upgrade.
That makes sense.
It looks like the PC version. Although it's 30 frames per second, it looks really nice. Fair enough. So, this one's just about Nintendo and how they've been kicking ass. The SNES Classic outsold the PS4 and Xbox in October.
Yeah, obviously, I'm not surprised.
You know,
never seen one on a shelf.
A little bit of an anomaly. It is only $100 system. It is playing on Nintendo fanboyism and nostalgia big time. Super Nintendo is an amazing.
And they've also said it's limited time only, so people are rushing out trying to make sure they get that.
It's hard to compare a $100 item versus a $300/$400 or $500 item when it comes to the Xbox One X. But also, at the same time, Switch, I believe, also in Canada, I believe, outsold PS4 and Xbox One.
As far as I was reading a similar one to the one that you're referring to right now, the Nintendo was responsible for with the SNES Classic and the Switch, we're talking almost half of all console sales for last month.
Yeah,
they were on its shoulders.
They just kicked ass,
you know. So that when you take that into consideration, that's crazy. But I mean, I think that this weekend and stuff, it's new. It's the new hotness. You know, a lot of people that, especially with PS4, I think a lot of people already own PS4s. They don't necessarily want to buy another one, or, you know, so there's that. There's also, you know, similar thing with the Xbox, but the Xbox One X is new and shiny, and that's exciting, especially for, you know, people with 4K TVs and a big fat wallet.
Assholes like me.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, and then of course the Switch, I think it's different enough, and also it's the new hotness, and I think a lot of people want to play it, and a lot of people want to get it.
You got games like Zelda and Mario, which are phenomenal.
Oh, totally. I mean, that new Mario game, a lot of people that know me have been asking about it. Like, is it really as good as people are saying it is? And,
yep.
You know, so that, of course, there's that little bit of Nintendo nostalgia for a lot of people, even just when it comes to the Switch, because they're like, oh man, I played The Legend of Zelda back in the day. It was great. Yeah, like
fringe gamers that have fallen out because of life and whatnot.
Yep, but they might want to come back and play a new Super Mario Brothers or Zelda game, right? So,
yeah, it's just a good news story. Nintendo could get us.
Totally.
You know, with the Wii U, they were really looking like they were on the fence there.
Yeah, and I mean, I just hope with them doing well, I say this with every time we talk about fucking Nintendo, but they, you know, some of their stupid decisions that they make, I just really hope they
figure their shit out.
They'll catch up eventually.
We've been saying that since they.
They're like 10. They're like 10 years. They're like 10 years behind. Maybe it's 15 painful. Or 20.
They're the only company that I know that is not like looking at what some of their competitors are doing, going like, you know, we should maybe implement some of this stuff.
Yeah,
it's not.
Pretty funny.
Like, oh, it's
this next story, Sega announces Valkyria Chronicles 4 for PS4, Xbox, and Switch. This is
pretty sweet.
That's a pretty cool story from left field. Like, I did not see this coming. They had like a spinoff earlier in the year. Was it Valkyria Revolution or something? I can't even remember, but it was poo-pooed. It was not very good. It had nothing to do with the PSP / Vita PS2 or PS3 games. The remaster came out, was it last year or earlier this year? It was a PS4 remaster of the first game.
Right.
I feel like it may have come out last year. The second one came out on PSP. And I think the third one came out on Vita, but only in Japan. It never made it here. And it's like a hybrid first-person strategy RPG super mega anime steampunk military game.
It's a tactical RPG, but from a view and a perspective that you would never really expect to see in a game like that. And like it's really cool.
And they have a huge cult following, like their beloved titles. Everyone was super upset that number 3 never came here. But obviously, I think with the Vita's life, aka market share, Sega's like, yeah, no, we're good. That ain't going to sell anything in North America, so we're not even going to bother. So everyone, I think, was obviously pleasantly surprised when they announced this. And man, on Switch, I know where I'm getting this game on Switch. Because it's stylized, cartoony graphics. You don't need a PS4 and Xbox. I do have the remaster. I have beaten the first and second games in this series. I really like them. So I saw the story. I'm like, what? No effing way. Like,
yeah, man.
It was almost exciting. Like, this ain't April 1st. What's going on? Elgato released a new version of their capture card. The 4K 60 Pro.
So nice.
Now that I got fiber.
$1 million.
I'm going to start capturing my videos in 4K and become YouTube famous.
Streaming in 4K. Better get a way bigger hard drive.
Yeah. The reason I talk about this is two things. One, you need like basically a super high-end PC. Like you need a gaming PC just to run this. Yep. Let alone, I don't know how well you could stream from a machine that's playing the game. I'm going to say you can't. I'm going to say you'd have to have a machine dedicated
streaming
streaming, because just the memory bandwidth I'd imagine that is required for 4K 60. Oh my God.
It's just the video decoding and encoding for stream would be insane.
Yeah, like you need
the encoding alone. I don't know if it would be able to do it in real time.
They recommend
while you're playing.
They recommend a pretty recent i7. They recommend a 10 series NVIDIA card. Like these are all high end. Like you basically need a high end gaming PC just to run this thing. Obviously, if you're doing Xbox One X or PS4 Pro. That's cool, but if you're planning to stream PC games, you're basically going to need like 2 towers.
Yeah.
I just wonder how this is going to work for like, it's capture card. I don't know if
can you stream
4K?
No, that's, like, I was just going
to
say,
you'd have to have fiber.
4K.
You could, theoretically, but you'd have to have fiber.
I don't know if Twitch supports 4K streaming, do they?
I don't know. Maybe YouTube does. I'll have to look into that. But even if they did...
Mixer might.
Even if they did, my expectation here is, number one, you have to have fiber. Because you're going to need at least 25 megabits up for 4K.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
yeah. For reliable, like for a stream that's going to look 4K. Like, you don't want 4K compressed. Otherwise, what's the point of streaming in 4K? You may as well be doing 1080p 60 with no compression, right?
Yep.
So, to get a true 4K stream, it's upwards of 25 megabits a second upload.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, good luck with your freaking cable modems and freaking DSL connections. Like, forget that noise. You need fiber for that. And then the other question is
fiber coming to my building.
Yeah, that's awesome. The other question is that, like, well, with people trying to stream this shit, are like ISPs gonna be like, whoa, what the is going on here? This is a little taxing on our backbone. Like, is there gonna be some throttling that might make this difficult to do, unrelated to even having the requirements to get here? Do you know what I mean? Because there's one thing that people are streaming like 1080, you know, at whatever 4 or 5 megs a second, plus or minus, depending on your up and down. That might float under the radar, but when people start really heavily using the system, that usually gets network people going, what is going on here?
Yeah, I think everybody is jumping on this whole 4K bandwagon.
A little too quick.
Oh, yeah. I would go as far as to say probably 90% of the people out there don't even have a 4K monitor or a 4K thing to watch it on.
No, it's definitely a minority.
So we're talking about, you know, oh man, I'm going to like start streaming 4K with the Elgato and whatever, but it's like, who the fuck is watching it? Like, you can offer the content, and I think it's a great idea to have that capability. There's people that
will watch it, but yeah, it's definitely the...
But who's watching it in 4K?
The minority of your office, or your your audience.
So, I think that people seem to sort of forget that about this whole 4K gold rush that everybody's trying to rush out and get 4K right now. I don't know. I think we're still, even, you know, Xbox One X, sure, it's definitely helpful and it's definitely a powerful system and we're going to be seeing a lot of great stuff coming out in 4K, but like, I don't think that even it is going to be pushing native 4K quite as much as Microsoft.
Just working on 4K video files brings a computer to its, well, it doesn't. No.
It depends on your PC.
That's a lie. It depends. You need specific apps. Like, I have 4K video files that I was trying to work with, and none of the freebie apps could handle it. Like,
no, you gotta be rocking, like, full-on Adobe Premiere.
I had to use Premiere. And it was beautiful.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. But again, you're working on, I mean, you now...
You know how big some of the video, you know, the video file? Like from your Assassin's Creed video from PAX?
Which was what, 30 minutes, 35 minutes?
I think your video is like 40 something minutes. Mine was like 20. Is that right? 250 gigs.
Yeah. Yeah. 4K is huge.
Yeah, that's insane.
Kiss but your then, bandwidth caps
but
goodbye.
Then again, well, see, that's the argument here now. So, like, that's uncompressed pure capture.
Yep.
I mean, 4K stream, 4K TV, 4K video on demand, that shit's compressed.
Yeah.
So, it's like, it kind of defeats the purpose of 4K almost, you know? It's like, well, if you got to go whole hog, you don't go at all. Like, I'd rather have an uncompressed 1080p than a compressed 4K, I think. I don't know. It's interesting. We're in interesting times. Literally, there's like 2 4K channels on most TV providers. Lineups. Right. And there's a handful of 4K movies you can get on video on demand. Netflix clearly has the highest amount of 4K content out there, I think, compared to anyone else.
Yeah. That, even they've been pushing it for a while, right?
Well, every new series they do is 4K, and then some of them are 4K and HDR. And to be honest, though, it's like, yeah, it looks good, but it's not like, holy cow, like, wow. Because at the end of the day, it's fucking compressed. It's not uncompressed because they have to be weary of data caps. Because, like, think about it. 200 gigs of 4K HDR, like... fucking one episode of Punisher, you're going to tell me I like burnt through my data cap and went over? Like these are things people don't realize. Like 4K is fine and dandy, but then when you get to the technical side of it, it's like we got some challenges ahead of us still. That's why the adoption's been so slow. The awesome thing is if you are a gamer, being a gamer is in my opinion, the best way and only way to experience true 4K. Because anything else besides being a 4K Blu-ray,
that was the other thing I was going to say is like if you're getting into Ultra HD Blu-rays, nothing is like 100% uncompressed, but that is the closest you're going to be getting to
the best video quality.
Proper, yeah, exactly. A lot of the other stuff, it's too big.
Yeah,
and that's the problem, right?
Man, I can't wait till we get 8K.
Well, and that's the question I think that a lot of people are asking these days are how long, like, is 4K going to be around? You know, like I think
4K for North America.
We've had 1080p since what, 2006? Is when 1080p really
longer than that?
No, but that's kind of when it went mainstream, right? Because that would have been the release of the PS3, so that would have been the release of right around the time that Blu-ray was released.
It's turning,
so we're looking at a little over 10 years.
Yeah, it's turning into the point at stores when you go to buy a TV, you can't buy a tube TV. And the only things TVs that aren't 4K nowadays are the low-end budget TVs.
Yeah, but they're like $300 or
maybe
whatever.
Maybe in a year, maybe two. I'm going to say two max. 2 years from now, I think you'll only be able to get a 4K TV. But the biggest challenge isn't the prices of TVs. It's just the backbone infrastructure to get the content.
Yeah.
It's just not there the majority of North America.
People are buying TVs
with nothing to play on it.
Exactly. They don't have anything to watch on them. They're just like, oh man, it's got 4K. It's awesome.
I feel sorry for anyone, like, and I see this every day because it's related to my work, my real life work job. People who buy 4K TVs to stream Netflix.
Oh,
they don't even have an Ultra HD player. They don't have an Xbox One or a PS4 Pro. And it's just like, I just shake my head. It's like, why did you spend $6,000 on this TV? That's just a waste of money. Because you're not even taking advantage of it, really.
But bro, it upscales all my stuff. But
bro, I can brag to all my other neighbors and family members who have no idea how this stuff works either. I guess if you got the money, flaunt it. Like, I'm one to talk. I'm an asshole with all the toys, but I use my toys, so...
Yeah.
This kills me when people, like, have this stuff and they don't even have anything hooked up to it to take advantage of it. I just laugh. It's like, you don't deserve this. I should just take it. Free it to a home of someone who would take advantage of it.
Yeah, I don't know. Like I said, I'm waiting on 4K here. I definitely don't feel a giant need to, like, rush out and... I feel like I'm waiting for HDR to become much more standardized because I think that is actually a bigger thing.
It's standardized.
Yeah, with two fucking standards.
No, HD10 has taken over. Dolby Vision. No. Dolby Vision is nobody's using it.
So there's that, and I just
if you were to buy a mid-range 4K TV today, if you were in the market for a TV. You'd be very happy, and they're not very expensive. They come down so much. Even the OLEDs have come down quite a bit.
See, and that was my other point, was I was going to say, and the other thing is I don't feel like the tech is all that different unless we're talking about OLED.
Yeah,
Quantum Dot's got its benefits, but ultimately,
that's what my TV is.
If I can get an OLED, that's... Yeah,
they were a little too expensive for my tastes. I didn't want to spend... I bought a $6,000 TV once, or maybe a $4,500 TV once. And yeah, I regretted that decision. So now you wait a couple of years and then you get the best bang for the buck. Like next year...
Oh, absolutely.
Next year you get the OLED for what I paid for the Quantum. And then you're just like, haha, you suck. My TV's better than yours.
That's always kind of been my...
my theory. So now, I'm in no rush. Like, I don't feel any, like, oh, man, I need to rush out and buy a 4K TV. Like,
we're going on a total, like, off the rails here. But, like, if your TV was dead or you didn't have a TV.
Oh, for sure.
Then get whatever you can afford, essentially. Don't get the top end. Don't ever do that. That's the worst mistake you could ever do.
Here's the problem I run into now, and that's becoming an actual problem, is that my wife absolutely loves 3D, and there's almost nobody making 3D 4K TVs.
No, it's done.
And like, if I wait too long on buying a 4K TV, then I'm not going to be able to watch any of my 3D Blu-rays anymore. So it's like,
yeah. Sorry, yeah, sorry, Dane.
It's kind of a brutal situation to be in. So yeah.
3D.
So we'll see how that all ends up shaking out at 3D, some point in the not too distant future.
Boo.
Yeah.
So moving on. Gran Turismo Sport has a big update coming in December. Adding more cars, and the one thing that you criticized the game for, and which I witnessed, was the non-standard campaign mode. They're adding a more traditional campaign, single player to the game. That's cool.
That's awesome.
That makes me happy.
Super cool.
I don't know if even people were really complaining, because I think the people who wanted that game knew what they were getting into, like you said.
Yeah, I just think it was a... I think that game is just made for a different audience than traditional Gran Turismo games have been. And that's... And I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I think it's really neat what they're trying to do, and I think if they make it work, I think it's really exciting. And it has a potential to be like a completely new thing. And a new esport, which is cool. I just, unfortunately, in the mix, they made a game that I'm just not really interested in as all.
Yeah. I bought it for the VR, and again, I got it for $50 from Amazon, so
yeah. Yeah, for sure.
We already talked about the loot box stuff. Screw you, EA, you're a bunch of suckers. I guess we can move on to public service announcements. Man, my phone has been blowing up Wario64 notifications going like crazy. The Black Friday deals have started, man. If there was a title you missed this year, right now, if you don't already follow at Wario64 on Twitter, you should. He's US centric. I have not found someone who is Canadian centric. I don't think one exists. Mainly because I don't think a lot of the Canadian retailers do associate programs or affiliate links like they do in the US. So no one's really incentivized to... Well, Red Flag Deals does it, and they have a video game section, but it's not as nice as someone who just goes through it and says, here's the best awesome crazy deals, here's the price errors. Like, that's what Wario does nonstop. He's a robot. He's like not even a human being. I don't know how he does it. Like, because
probably got bots.
He tweets at all hours of the day and night. Like, my watch is going crazy right now. I'm gonna have to go pick up some games. I have taken advantage of one of the Black Friday deals in the US, and it's because I had like credit at Amazon. Right. I ended up getting the Skyrim VR PSVR bundle.
Nice.
Because it was $350 American compared to $579 Canadian. Like, even after the conversion, it's still cheaper. I don't think most of the Canadian retailers are blowing out the Gran Turismo bundle, which is the old headset.
Right.
Like, had there been only a headset only version with the new headset, I would have been all over that, but I don't want the old headset. I want the new headset. And the only way to get that right now is in the Skyrim bundle. So anyway, it was $350 and I had $100 credit at Amazon, so it was like $250. The only thing that sucks is I had to ship it to one of my friends and they got to ship it to me. So, but even after the extra cost of shipping to get here, I'm probably going to be saving like upwards of $200. So I'm paying a very minimal upgrade fee after selling my old headset, which makes me happy because two things. I'm getting Skyrim. I'm getting the new camera and I'm getting the new Move controller. So I'm going to sell off like my old controllers and camera.
Nice.
Recoup a little bit more money there. I've heard mixed things about Skyrim, but I've heard some really awesome things about it. And I'm pretty sure, being someone who doesn't get sick in VR, I think I will find something to appreciate there. And then I'll also finally be able to play Gran Turismo in VR because I haven't had a headset to do that. And that's the whole reason I own that stupid game.
Which is kind of funny.
I'm pretty excited to get the new headset. So I have partook already in the Black Friday deals. And I'm glad I did because that like sold out like instantly. Because that's a pretty good freaking deal, dude. $350.
That's a really good deal, yeah.
With everything. So I don't know. You might still be able to find that at other retailers down in the States. That's just the Sony incentivized Black Friday price. There are tons of other deals. Like I think Assassin's Creed is $25 or $30 at most retailers. Like most of the AAA games are easily half price or like $30 off. Keep your eyes posted to Wario's tweets and or Cheap Ass Gamer has a forum post with all the deals. I think they even have a crazy spreadsheet like covering every game in retailers. So you could just go like, oh, they got it cheap. Just I'm gonna get it there.
Good old Black Friday.
I saw some deals on, like he was tweeting out. And I'm like, oh man, Injustice for $15. I'm like, wow, that's cheap. That's at GameStop, but GameStop.com ships to Canada. I'm like, I might take advantage of that because there's a couple other games that are like $20. I'm like, oh man. Anyway, after your dinner, or if, man, it seems like these deals have already gone live. Hopefully you guys make out with some good deals. Animal Crossing, Pocket Camp, which came out a while ago in Australia.
It is currently out now.
I haven't playing anything on my phone lately. I just haven't had time. I've been so busy at work.
I've downloaded it. I haven't actually like even launched it since
I suspected when I talked about playing the Australian version, because some people were worried like, oh, I don't want to play that version because my progress won't carry over. No, my progress carried over. Like I suspected, you could link your Canada account and it updated, and now my shit's linked and I got to play it for 3 weeks, which I barely played, but anyway, whatever. That's out now on Android and iOS. Check it out. It's free.
Sweet.
And I don't know how their economy goes in terms of the bells or the cash or whatever the hell's in it. I have like 300 and something tickets, which is enough to buy like KK Slider or what's his nuts, Tom Nook. So I've barely played the game. So obviously there is microtransaction stuff in there, but it's obviously not that bad.
Yeah.
I
said, I'll probably launch it tomorrow or whatever. And
this is a link to a video. I gotta find a better link for the Xbox Games of Gold. I have the wrong link here. Our next story. Xbox announced their Games with Gold for December. We've got... if I can find it here.
Too exciting, but it's not terrible.
Did you find it already? Man, where the hell is it?
I read it earlier.
Why can't I find this?
So it's going to be first-person shooter Warhammer End Times Vermintide. Then it's going to be another great Telltale adventure game, which is Back to the Future, the game, the 30th anniversary edition. And then you're going to get Child of Eden. And then later on in December is Marlo Briggs and the Mask of Death. There you go. So those are the... Those are the four for this month.
I got a proper link
Games
now.
With Gold.
Yeah.
And if you hurry, you can still get the Tales from the Borderlands from last month.
I'm going to say that's another definite meh month.
Vermintide, I've heard actually really good things about.
Have you? Oh, well,
yeah, it's like a kind of a co-op shooter, a little bit like... what's that zombie game that Valve did, Left 4 Dead? It's kind of like that.
Huh.
But in the
Warhammer universe.
In the Warhammer universe. So I've heard good things about it. Apparently it's a lot of fun to play co-op, so might be a good like free co-op game to play with some friends or whatever.
Not in my wheelhouse.
Me neither.
I guess we can get into free for all.
Yeah.
So I picked up an Xbox One Play and Charge kit.
Okay.
The other day. Now, I don't know if... No, it has to be the battery pack. Anyway, so I got this thing. I charged it overnight. I'm playing my Xbox, and this is today. And it's like, low battery. I'm like, what are you talking about? I charged this thing last night. You lost connection. I'm like, what?
Ew.
Hit my button again. Reconnects. And this is my brand new, like, Project Scorpio Xbox One controller.
Right.
I'm like, okay, here we go. Going back. You've lost connection. Okay. Hmm. Do it again. Fine. For like an hour or two. Come back to the system. Do it again. Same thing. I take it out. I reinsert it. I'm like, I must just have a bum battery pack because I had no issues with just two AA batteries. And I'm like, why the F did I buy this thing?
My experience with the Playin charge kits is not great.
Yeah, my 360 ones all randomly died at the exact same time.
Yeah, I had one for my 360 and it wasn't great. I've actually had the best luck with Sanyo Antelope rechargeable batteries. They are like really awesome rechargeable batteries, and those are by far and away the best thing that I use on my for pretty much everything. If it needs a AA battery, and even AAA, I have actually got some AAAs for it now as well. Those are amazing. Like,
yeah, I have rechargeables. I have Duracell ones right now, and
yeah, these ones are amazing because you can charge them and leave them in the drawer, and they don't discharge like a lot of.
Yeah, I hear good things.
They're
about
really good ones.
What are they?
They used to go on sale. Right? Yeah, they're the Sanyo Antelope ones. They used to go on sale on a somewhat frequent basis at NCIX, and so I'd just wait and I'd just pick up a pack of them for like $20, and you get like 10 batteries or whatever. And
oh wow!
Oh yeah, no, they're awesome. I have multiple packs of them here at home, and I use them for all kinds of stuff. And they're great.
I think if it happens again on my next PlayStation, it's going back because there's clearly nothing wrong with my controller, because with normal batteries, it's never disconnected or done weirdness. Works fine. So I'm hoping it's just a bum pack, it has to be a bum pack because it can't be the controller, because like I said, regular batteries work. So that was kind of a bummer because I was pretty excited. I'm like, oh, I get this and then I can charge it and I don't have to deal with batteries and shit. And no, I still have to worry about batteries and shit. Before we talk about what you wrote down there on the outline, I also did some surgery. I brought my Moto 360 back to life.
Dude, I was going to ask you about that. I wanted to know where you ordered your battery from I need to do the same thing. So
for
badly.
Because your wife is always in the States, you could probably find a battery on Amazon.com. And yeah, they're like super cheap. I think like $15. I bought mine from a battery store in Vancouver.
Oh, interesting.
Because you can't ship batteries across the border because batteries are just a pain in everyone's ass. Because they can't go on planes. They have to go ground and all this bullshit.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Especially if they're lithium
or
whatever.
My brother found a place in Vancouver. It was like 40. I think it was like $40 plus or minus. But
I would gladly pay that.
Because you were having what I was having where your phone would just crash or it would die like very quickly, right?
I pull it off, like even right now, like I pull it off the charger and it'll show that I, like on the charger, it'll show I have 100% battery, and I'll pull it off the charger and then it just either it will work for like 5 minutes or it just as soon as I take it off the charger, it just like crashes and shuts off.
Yeah, if
I put it back on the charger, then it reboots itself, and I'm like, oh, okay, interesting.
Yeah, that's what mine was doing. So, anyway, if you're in the U.S., I don't know if you have this watch, you can probably get a battery for $15. If you're up here in Canada, it's around $40. Either way, that being said, it is a little bit of a harrowing experience because, one, I wouldn't recommend doing it unless you have a electronics repair toolkit with like tiny tweezers and the little pry picks and so forth.
Which I do.
Because if you don't have that, it's going to be a pain in the ass to take the watch band off. You're probably going to break the back plate. But yeah, I watched some videos on YouTube, and then I just like, okay, I'm going to do this. And
I need to order a new backplate anyways, because mine's got giant cracks in it. So
yeah. If it has giant cracks in it, then there's definitely no fear. But I managed to do mine quite easily and quickly without wrecking the backplate. And it was kind of hairy, like having to disconnect the screen connectors and whatnot. And you got to really, it's easy, not easy, right?
Right.
Definitely watch a video.
It's like anytime you got to deal with like phone shit. Like I've replaced like screens and stuff on cell phones and whatnot.
Yeah.
You got to go slow. You got to take your time, and it's a bit of a tedious process. It can be.
And have the right tools.
Yeah.
So that being said, I put my new battery in. I charge my watch overnight. Right now it's 23%. It's like 10 o'clock at night.
It's working way better.
Yeah. This thing's been going, like I'm telling you, I'm getting notifications like crazy right now because of all these Black Friday deals Wario's posting. My phone's been vibrating, or my wrist has been vibrating nonstop this evening while I've been recording. I'm super happy because I just felt naked without my watch. I was so used to it.
I know. I'm in the similar boat. And the thing is like I've kickstarted another smartwatch, but it's probably not going to be here till January, maybe February at this point.
Oh, which one was
but
that?
I still really miss having a smartwatch. So I'm in that spot where I really want my, like, so for me, even though I have a new one on the way, like $40 for me to fix the one that I've got right now and use it till then would be
worth it.
Easily acceptable in my opinion. So.
I can send you the link after we're done.
Yeah. Yeah, no, definitely.
I don't know. I just, with my fixing my PS, one of my PS4 controllers this year, fixing my watch, I don't know.
You like to tinker.
Yeah, I just like fixing stuff because there's no reason to throw half of this stuff out when you can inexpensively fix it and make it brand new again yourself. Like, we've gotten so reliant on if you just can't go to Best Buy and here, fix this, which they don't fix anything. Society's been like, just throw it away. But we have the means and the tools to fix this shit ourselves. It is a little, you know, trust me, it was a little scary. I'm like, but it didn't work. So worst case scenario, what? I break the thing that doesn't work?
Yeah, that's the way I look at it.
So like, I was already used to not having it. So what damage could I do at that point? So anyway, it's pretty gratifying feeling when you do something like that. It's like, I'm freaking hacker, dude, man.
That's funny.
So
I had a chance earlier to take a look at the Essential phone in person for the first time. Yeah. I gotta say, that is a sexy piece of kit, man. It is really nice. That screen on there is so pretty. I hate that it's not on my carrier and I'd have to buy it outright. It sucks.
I wonder, can you buy it outright unlocked?
Yep. Yep.
Well, it is definitely cheaper now.
I know. If you're in the, if you're looking for a new phone, take a look at that thing because it is really nice.
It's $650 in Canada right now. Is that the price?
Yeah.
That's pretty freaking good compared to everything else.
I know. It's a nice phone.
Like everything else is like $1,000 plus.
It's got a ceramic back, really nice screen on the front. Feels awesome in the hand. It's got like the edge to edge screen. It is a solid, like I was really impressed with it.
Yeah, I've seen it.
If it was on my carrier, I'd swap over to it. I would. But anyways, that's a little side note. It was something that happened to me earlier, and I was like, oh, man.
So you had a chance to see Blade Runner?
Yeah. Me and some guys at work on Monday, we went and watched it.
On Monday? Like Monday night?
Yeah. Oh. Yeah, a couple of us. I mean, our work is, we're like 3 blocks away from the theater, so we're super close to the theater.
From
so
the
we
Colossus?
Just, yeah. I don't know if they call it that anymore, but anyways, went and saw it, and I really liked it.
It's a pretty cool flick.
I really, really liked it a lot. I thought they did an awesome job. I love the fact that if you went into this looking for answers from the first movie, you're not going to get it at all. Like, if you walked into that movie wondering whether or not, you know, the big question from the first movie, whether or not Deckard was a replicant, this movie, not going to tell you the answer to that question. It's a completely different story, and it's great, and I love it. I thought that was really cool. I thought that Ryan Gosling does an awesome job.
Yeah, he was fantastic. I thought
visually it's like stunning. It's beautiful.
Did you get what I meant about like the audio track of that movie? It's just jarring.
Oh, it's great. I love it. I know what you mean though. It's like the sounds and like these long, almost like siren blasts and like,
and just bass lines that are just like,
like all of a sudden,
it's so aggressive.
Yeah. No. What a great movie. If you're a fan of the first one, I feel like they did an awesome job of.
I want a joy AI. Isn't that not cool?
That was pretty cool.
Yeah, so if you haven't seen the flick, instead of virtual reality, it's augmented reality, and the AI companion in Blade Runner is basically like a projection that follows you around. But it just seems, because it's, you're not wearing anything, I don't know how it's, obviously they don't explain the tech or if it can even be possible in our world, which would be cool. But it's just neat because you're seeing this AI follow you around and interact with you like they're there.
Yeah, it was very interesting. It was a very interesting take on that whole, just the whole where...
Just, this is where AR could eventually be, right?
Yeah. I won't lie, they paint a bleak ass.
Oh, the future sucks.
Future. But... Oh my god, the future in that movie.
But everyone on Earth sucks. Like,
that universe is just unbelievably bad.
Where are all the rich people? They're on Mars or the moon?
They're on they just say off planet.
Yeah,
they just call it off planet. They're like, yep, we can get you off planet.
If you're on Earth, it's like, you poor Kenny.
Yeah, pretty much. And it's half of it's radioactive from when like they nuked stuff, and it's not a happy world, that's for sure. That being said, like that movie is great. Not for the faint of heart. Like it's got some good stuff in there, but it's rated R. It's definitely not a kid's movie. But no, I really enjoyed it. I feel like if you're a fan of the first one, then I think that they did right by you. So yeah, that's, I don't want to spoil anything for anybody that's still on the fence of wanting to go see it, because I feel like there's so much that you could talk about. That movie's super deep. One of the things that I absolutely love that they do is they don't rush scenes. Like, it's a long movie. It's 2.5 hours. But the scenes, one of the things that drives me crazy sometimes in movies is that a situation will arise and a guy or girl will run up and they'll, hey, we got to do this thing. And or there'll be a big bomb that'll get dropped, like, oh, hey, I'm your son or I'm your daughter or whatever. And it's like, they don't even take the moment to process that. They just kind of like, oh, wow, okay. And then they react and they move on, which I get because it's a movie. But I loved the fact that in this movie, they take that time in those scenes where there is those big things and it's not just a quick, oh, yeah, this thing happened and, oh, okay, great, we're moving on. It felt very realistic. The scenes where people needed to be like quick and getting out of there, they were doing that. And the scenes where they... you know, that is a lot of information and it's very life changing. They take the time to let that sort of sink in and be life changing and, awesome. Love it. It's so good. So
yeah.
I knew you would have liked it, in my opinion. Yeah. Worth seeing in the theater too. Cause just the visual, spectacle
for the sound system.
Oh yeah. Just visually and yeah, audibly, it's just, ugh. Yeah. So,
Dane?
Yo.
I think we have an episode 132.
I think you're right.
You can follow me on Twitter at Rick F, R-I-C-F, no K.
You can always come hang out with me on Twitter at Dane Cody, at D-A-Y-N-E-C-O-D-Y.
Every time I say it, my Twitter handle, I feel like I say it wrong. Anyway, make sure to like us on Facebook, Geekoholics. Subscribe to us on YouTube, Geekoholics. Follow us on Twitter, Geekoholics. Congratulations to Aquatic Zero, who won the Assassin's Creed copy. He was really happy about that, because I think he said he was actually about to go buy that game the day that he won it. So,
oh, that's exciting.
I imagine he's enjoying that.
We will post the winner on Facebook and Twitter just to let people know.
I already posted it.
Okay.
It was
because we've definitely been getting people that have been asking.
Stuff gets buried, so it's like,
I know.
So hard with social media. Like, you can think that you're putting a message out there that everyone sees, and it's like, no. You got to pay Facebook to make sure everyone sees it.
Yeah, that's
enough. As suspected, we're going to start our next contest here. We're going to be giving away a Super NES Classic.
What?
Which some of you guys may have suspected, because I was kind of hinting at one of the hottest items this fall. Wow. I haven't posted the hoops to jump through on that one yet. I don't know how I'm going to do it. I was almost thinking about doing it like a radio show, like listen to the podcast for the keyword to enter each week.
Ooh, that's a good idea.
But I think it's going to be something similar to that, and it's going to run until like Christmas or the end of the year, because it is a pretty coveted item. I would like to get as much attention for that as possible. So keep a lookout for that, because that's going to be a pretty cool prize for someone.
It's pretty exciting.
Yeah. With that being said, I think we're done, my friend. Thanks for listening.
That's it.
Rate us on all your favorite podcasting platforms. Share us with your friends. And until next week, we are out.
I gotta go play Assassin's Creed.
Yeah, me too. Later. Peace.